Welcome, everyone. Khosh amadid, ahlan wa sahlan. I'm delighted to welcome you to our 10th webinar on our 8th Teatime with She. My name is Navid Madani. I'm a mother, I'm a mentor, and a scientist at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and affiliate of Harvard Medical School. I'm also the founding director of the She Center. Our focus is on global health and professional development, and the main objective of our center is to build a sustainable and meaningful two-way dialogue of ideas and methodology to support scientific education and improve healthcare and training for young people in the United States and Middle East and North Africa, or MENA. All of this is through mentoring with a focus on female clinician and scientists. The center at Dana-Farber prioritizes youth education and awareness surrounding critical issues of equity and representation, and aims to uniquely address these issues through media, virtual engagement, and in-person connections. Since the start of the pandemic and the absence of our in-person workshops, we have pivoted and initiated She webinars and Teatime conversations. These platforms are designed for all of us to learn from experts in the field as an oral history of science, medicine, economy, and sociology, and most of all, leadership. Today's Teatime is part of that mission. I am extremely privileged, both personally and professionally, to introduce our speaker today, Mr. Maz Jobrani. Maz is an Iranian-American comedian, actor, author, and advocate whose career has bridged critical dialogue between race, identity, health, and media. Originally from Tehran, my hometown, and my country of Iran, my birth country, Maz has been an outspoken activist for the promotion of inclusivity and representation in American media. This dedication has aimed to reform misaligned narratives on Middle Eastern identity and culture in America specifically, and reframe discussions of identity through comedy and entertainment. His pursuit of positive change also extends to health sector through his advocacy for COVID vaccination, or his board position for the Persian American Cancer Institute and his involvement with the International Society for Children and Cancer, with cancer, something that is very close to our heart here at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. The She Center is incredibly honored to facilitate an in-depth discussion with Maz relating to his background and broaden our audience's understanding of health issues, disparities, and needs in the MENA region, and how to engage our community for positive change. Maz, welcome, and thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me. The privilege is mine.
Thank you, Maz. And to our audience members, please use your Q&A text box to send us any questions you may have. So Maz, you have a wonderful segment on your social media called Persian Word of the Week. I really enjoy it. My American friends found it extremely useful. This week, I think it was Bachanane. So today's Persian word of the week for our Teatime is khalaqiyat, or creativity, thinking outside of the box. When we have our workshops, we have to always have our workshop based on the culture and custom of the country we are in. You have had the opportunity to perform in venues around the world and meet individuals that coming from hosts of backgrounds. How do you create and modulate your performances based on the community in which you're performing? How does this reflect your, you know, thinking?
I think for the most part, when we create as comedians, we just write about what's funny to us, and there's different types of comedians. Some will actually sit down and write in a notebook and write the jokes. I tend to write on stage, so I will take either something I've seen or observed or read or an experience I had, and I'll take that to stage. And I live in Los Angeles, so in LA, when you perform as part of a series of comedians where everybody gets 15 to 20 minutes. So when I go up and I perform that 15 or 20 minutes, I may have a new thing that happened to me. So I'm going to try 2 minutes of new stuff and 13 minutes of older stuff just to make sure that the audience gets a good show as well. And as we work that material and we keep going and we get on stage 5 to 10 times a week, you rework it, you record it on your phone, you listen to it, you think about it, etc. And eventually that turns into something that has its beats and its rhythms and its punchlines. Now you've created jokes that you put into a 1 hour long set, which is what you do when you travel and you headline, which you saw in Boston, for example. So when I travel, whether it's another city or another country, quite often I have the same hour of material that I would do in Los Angeles, I might do in Saudi Arabia. However, sometimes you show up in a place like Saudi Arabia or let's say somewhere in the Middle East or wherever, and they might say, look, you know, we have a couple of things, no cussing, you know, like I remember the first time I went to the Middle East, I said, no sex, no religion, no politics. And we're like, okay, well then hello and good night. Like there's nothing else. But you learn that you can finesse some stuff if you need to. If you need to pull some things out, you might sit there and go, okay, this is maybe it's a little too risque, or maybe it's too edgy because the crowd is bringing their, you know, 5-year-old kids and you don't want to necessarily use bad words or whatever it might be. But the one other thing that you find out is when you do your show, you realize how much we have in common. So the same laughs that I got in LA, I got in Melbourne, and I got in Stockholm, and I got in Amman. I mean, that's the other thing that you realize is we do have a lot in common. So when I tell a story of growing up with my parents, my Iranian parents, you know, there'll be people in Mexico who have similar experiences of growing up with their parents and the way they viewed their parents. So again, I think for the most part, you can keep your act the same in terms of creativity, but you do need to, A, sometimes pay attention to the social norms of where you are. Secondly, the other thing you can do, and I try to do, is if I have a day or two in that city or in that country, I will try and find some material that pertains to them so they know that I'm paying attention to them as well. And I think that's always a great way to start the show, is to start with something that's been going on in their place and then take them on your journey.
Absolutely. No, it kind of makes you grow too. I mean, both of us are from Middle East, but going from Iran to Saudi Arabia to, you know, Oman to Jordan, there are always these different scenarios that, at least in my field of health and science, I felt like it had made me grow more to think outside of the box and be able to relate, you know, relate to them. And then the other thing that you mentioned, and it's so true, is, you know, through these, you know, connections and travels, you find that we have so much more in common than what we don't, you know. I mean, it's a true, you know, minority that, you know, we can talk about, you know, some things that we disagree on, but what we have in common is so much more. I want to switch a little bit to health and what motivated you to work with the Persian American Cancer Foundation and the International Society for Children with Cancer. And how do you bridge your work as a comedian with cancer and activism?
You know, what happened was I became a comedian. I started doing stand-up comedy in 98. And I think coming out of those years, I was originally I was the first Iranian-American comedian performing in America. And what would happen is there was all these different Iranian organizations, you know, for cancer or for, Iranian rights, Iranian-American rights, or you pick the subject, there was always somebody doing something, because as you know, within our community, there are people who thankfully are wanting to give back. Some of them are very successful and they start a foundation. You know, there's Pars Foundation, which helps Iranians and Afghans and others assimilate into America. There's also American organizations like non-Iranian, I should say, not Iranian American, but just white American, something called Mary's List. They help refugees resettle in America. So all of that said, what happened was, I think since I was the only game in town when it came to comedy, I got tapped. A lot of people would call me up and say, I have an event, can you come host it? And I was, and I've always been very supportive of anybody's charity. And I go, sure, why not? So that was early on. And then as a comedian, that becomes part of your job. I mean, it actually is like, you know, some of these things are paid jobs when you go and you host an event and you're getting paid. Of course, for charities, you get paid less, but still, it's part of your job. And so eventually what happened was I was overwhelmed. I had so many people. Every week I was getting somebody going, oh, we're raising money for, you know, the homeless here, and then the, you know, that storm over there. And it was like, and at a certain point, again, as a touring comedian, you go, I have my own calendar. I can't just, and I have a family. I can't just, because there was times where I'd be home off the road from touring, and then I'd come home and I would have to say to my wife and kids, oh, I gotta go host an event. And they're like, we haven't seen you and you're leaving again. So I had to learn to balance all that. So along the way, I tried to pick a handful of organizations that I said, okay, I will be there for you guys once a year or whatever it is. Let me know. Let's just let me know what it is so I can schedule that in. So one of the first ones was the Persian American Cancer Institute. There's a lady by the name of Huri Sadler who had breast cancer herself. And then she realized coming out of it that the Persian community and a lot of immigrant communities don't have organizations that deal with cancer as openly. She felt that people were ashamed of cancer, almost like, don't tell anyone you had cancer. So she went the opposite. She said, I'm going to tell people I had cancer, and I'm going to encourage Iranians to talk about this. And I think this is a model that could be used for many other immigrant communities. And the job of the Persian American Cancer Institute became to encourage Iranians and others to sign up for the bone marrow registry. Because as you know, when you have someone who needs a bone marrow transplant there, they usually match with someone from their own background. It's not 100% that, but quite often it is. And then when you look at the bone marrow registry, a lot of people, like the Iranians, don't have as many people in the registry as we should. And so, I mean, that seems pretty easy to me. If somebody's, you know, 40 years old, and if they don't find a match, they're going to die. Well, then I'm going to register and be the match to give them blood to survive, right? So similarly, we encourage people to do that, and we would do events, and I was on the board, and you know, COVID has kind of slowed us down a little bit, but hopefully we'll be active again some more. Similar to International Society for Children with Cancer, that's an organization that would raise money for a cancer institute back in Iran. And so again, they said, can you come to our gala once a year, host it, help us raise money? And they were doing a great job. They were raising a lot of money and sending it there. And you know, it's one of those things where you see the video from the hospital of people in Iran who can't afford the treatments, and this money's going to help them. So those were two very, you know, for me, if I have the time, and I've now learned to manage my time a little bit, because it used to be the way you are when you find what you love doing, comedy being that for me, you just say yes all the time. Yes, 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 yes. And so somebody says, I got a show here. Yes. I got a show there. Yes. 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 But then as you go, you start realizing, wait a minute, if I say yes to all this stuff, by the time I get in my car and I drive or I fly and this and that, sometimes I'm missing out on, like I said, my own family, or I'm missing out on my own health, or I'm missing out, you know, I'm just spreading myself too thin. So I've learned a little bit to talk people through that as well, because again, people will contact me all the time and say, we have an event here, we have an event there. And I'm going, God, I wish I were independently wealthy and my kids were fully grown and independent, and I could just fly around the world participating in every charity event. But unfortunately, I can't. And by the way, when I say I wish, I in all honesty, I don't wish that. I'm enjoying my kids you know, growing up. So I have to prioritize that as well.
No, I completely agree with you. I think the take home message and pretty much what you said right now is follow your passion. I mean, we are here to mentor young people too. Follow your passion, but have a balanced life. Be able to say no, you know, at times. I mean, it's hard, but you know, and right now, you know, we have to do that, especially with the pandemic. You know, we do everything on Zoom, but it has seemed like we are busier than ever. You know, even though we are cutting time on driving to places and all that, but still we seem like we are busier than ever. Speaking of the pandemic, your Instagram messages on getting vaccinated and about vaccination and your, you know, positive outlook, you know, your time in the closet was, you know, some of the best talks that you could give to general public. What do you think? This is a conversation I had with some of my colleagues where, you know, when the pandemic happened and there were so much questions around integrity of science and scientists and what is right and what is, you know, there was so much misinformation. I felt like, you know, as scientists, we need to really be able to connect with general public. What do you think as an entertainer, that have a very good communication with general public, as scientists and physician scientists, what can we do better to relay the message of science to people?
Well, you were talking about the closet. I was calling them the closet rants, because what happened was under the lockdown, my family was home all the time. So I really didn't have anywhere where I could make videos except going into the closet. So that became part of the joke. And I go in the closet and I would rant. And I did a rant about the vaccine. And, you know, I've always been someone who believes in science. So I tried to listen to the scientists when it came to coronavirus. I never thought of it as a hoax. I know that a lot of people try to find conspiracies and say it was man-made and it was for this reason and that reason. But I tend to lean against conspiracies simply because, being an Iranian American, a lot of Iranian Americans or a lot of Iranians are conspiracy theorists, because we have the 1953 coup of Mohammad Mossadegh that was run by the CIA. So we see that the CIA has been involved with things in the past, and that's not just in Iran, but it's also Chile and you know, Nicaragua, you name it, they've been involved. But I also feel when you put everything into the conspiracy bag, then you take away responsibility from yourself. You say, I have no control over everything. So there's some big powers pulling the strings and it's all written already. So what's the point? So when you come to something like coronavirus, if you think that it's some big conspiracy theory with Bill Gates and George Soros and Dr. Fauci and all these guys, well, then again, once we get to a point where we go, okay, well, how about social distancing? Well, your conspiracy theory mind is going to go, I know why you want me to social distance, because you're trying to implement 5G technology and you need us to stand apart so that you can put in your technology. All right, fine. How about you don't do the social distancing? How about you wear a mask? I know why you want us to wear a mask, because the mask is what the Nazis did when they were taking people into the chamber. I don't even, like, sometimes I don't even follow the logic. Right. Okay, you know what? For no distance, no mask. How about a vaccine? I know why you want me to take the vaccine, because this vaccine is going to control me. You're going to put a chip. You're going to follow me. So at a certain point, you go, okay, what am I dealing with? Am I dealing with someone who is logical, or are they so far gone that no matter what I say, I may say to them, forget the shot, forget the vaccine, forget social distancing. How about the cure to COVID is go outside and just breathe in the air? That person, if they're so far gone, they might say, oh, I know, you put something in the air. You don't want me to, I'm not going to breathe the air. I'm going to stay inside. I'm going to hold my breath. I mean, you know, that's what I'm saying. So as scientists, I guess the first question is, who are you dealing with? I think there's a percentage of the population, no matter what you say, they're going to totally be skeptical of what your motivations are. So that's going to be really hard to convince them to do anything. Then you've got a lot of people who I think have genuine concerns when it comes to the vaccines. I've heard people say, well, I'm a pregnant woman. I don't know if I should get the vaccine. What are the effects? And I know that you can look at research and say, well, research has shown that, you know, pregnant women have gotten it and they've been fine. Or or we have this thing now that's come out with the Moderna vaccine for male, you know, males, I think between the age of, I don't know, it was like 15 to 25 or whatever, where it was affecting their heart, slight heart issue. I actually listened to a great podcast. Joe Rogan interviewed Sanjay Gupta. Mm-hmm. That was a great podcast to listen to because they both had their own takes on it. Mm-hmm. And when Rogan kept saying, well, a young, healthy person could either get it and be fine, or the side effects with this heart condition, to him, he was saying, feels more detrimental. And then Gupta was saying, well, let's just remember that the people that were affected with the heart thing were, I don't know, 5 in 1,000,000, or it was very few. And those are just side effects that he, you know, you give peanuts to 1,000,000 people, there's going to be a bunch of them that are going to have an allergic reaction. So it was an interesting conversation. And for me, what was interesting was because I know Joe Rogan and he's very healthy. And he was like, I don't want to take it from my body. And Gupta was saying, okay, I'm going to agree with you that people that are healthy might not necessarily need it per se themselves. But the final thing that happened was in that conversation, they said, well, is America, they said, maybe Americans will now learn, because we're so unhealthy as is, maybe Americans will learn to be healthy after this pandemic. And they both laughed. They're like, no, there's no chance. They're going to keep eating hamburgers and McDonald's and drinking Coke and vaping and everything else. And then Gupta said, well, then that's more reason to get the general population vaccinated, because for the most part, the Joe Rogans and the other super healthy people are a minority in the country versus the unhealthy. And so if more of us get vaccinated, that will get us closer to that herd immunity. And also the other thing that we're told a lot is, even if you're healthy, get vaccinated for your kids, who hopefully soon can get vaccinated, to not spread it to others. And I know this sometimes, you know, the problem is, you know, the science is always changing, right? So the vaccine, we have breakthrough cases, right? But then we go, okay, but then statistically speaking, the ones who end up having a breakthrough case, their case isn't as severe, you know, when you see hospitalizations are mostly unvaccinated. So you can go back and forth with all of this stuff. But the thing that I heard that worked, that seems inspirational to me, was I think there was a medical professional who, I don't know what state it was a southern state, and I think she was African American, and we know from the Tuskegee experiment, yeah. I always mispronounce that word.
Yeah.
We know that the African American community was skeptical, right, early on of the vaccine, and this lady, she went into the community and she found people who had not been vaccinated. I think she was maybe going through neighborhoods, and she was, I don't know if she was a nurse or she was a doctor, but she was going and like knocking on doors and saying, look, I got it. These people got it. Millions of people got it. It's fine. It's better for you, because if you don't do it, and giving them, you know, what would happen. And she was able to earn their trust. So I guess if you and the others in the medical community and the scientific community want to get through, I think it's always good to have representation. Mm-hmm. So if you, first of all, if you can find people that you're talking to that are of your background, who might be skeptical. I guarantee you, if you held a seminar with a handful of Iranian Americans who were skeptical, and you said, look, here's the statistics, here's how it's worked. Mm-hmm. And also you, as an Iranian American, you could say, look, people in Iran are suffering and want it right now. Like, we, you know, we are lucky to have the chance to get it. And what are you afraid of? Let's talk about what you're afraid of. And I think in that kind of situation, you're gonna convince a lot more people to go ahead and get it, and realize that then the bigger risk is not getting it and either getting COVID, getting the long-term effects. And you can speak more to that than I can. But I think if you can find representation and put people from those backgrounds to go into those communities and really reiterate that hundreds of millions, if not, I don't know, 1 billion doses, there's been a lot of doses that have been given. And right. When you hear about the side effects, it's such a small percentage, and that's going to happen with any medicine.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I was, you know, we are waiting for clinical trials to be done for COVID vaccine for ages 5 to 11 kids. And a pediatric oncologist colleague of mine reminded me that for a lot of chemo drugs for kids, we don't have clinical trials. So the benefit to risk ratio just for COVID vaccination, it just outweighs the risk so much. And you're absolutely right. We need to be able to engage the public. As a virologist, I've put together, with the help of my colleagues, we put together a series of PowerPoint presentation that brings down how COVID infects the cells, how it takes over the system. And with a little bit of lay science, we're hoping we can get connected to people. And, a lot of, you talked about conspiracy theory. One of them was that how come we got the vaccine so fast? But the bottom line is that, the vaccine, COVID vaccine so fast came about on the shoulder of, HIV vaccinologists working on HIV vaccine for, almost 40 years. So it's been, the science has been evolving and, progressing, and that's why we were successful in such a short time. I think you alluded, we are getting questions from our audience members. Dr. Sheikh Hussein says, current public health issues over anti-vaccine, especially refusal of COVID-19 vaccine, how would you convey acceptable messages? I think you alluded to that based on the last question I had. And then let's see, we have an anonymous attendee that asked, Maz, can you tell us a science joke?
A science joke, okay. Here's one that my nephew told me. What do you call money in outer space?
Money.
You're supposed to say what?
What? Yeah.
Starbucks. Okay, I didn't write that. My nephew gave me that one. So that's science. It's not the kind of science you do, but it's, space.
That's a good one. And then another question we have from Mahtab. I believe as a whimsically humorous, innovative clinical pharmacist in my practice, I help my patients to develop a new perspective about their disease management in neurology, which was helpful. What is your opinion about laughter as a medicine, as a complementary addition to disease state management prescribed by healthcare? And how do you use humor when you get sick yourself?
Well, I've been saying on stage, I said when the pandemic hit, I went online and I Googled to find out if comedians are essential workers. And then usually the audience laughs at that point and I go, that's not the joke, that's the setup to the joke. And then I say, because they always say laughter is the best medicine. I go, unless you're really sick, then medicine is the best medicine. And I say, I don't want you to send me an email and be like, our dad, had a cold, we showed him your comedy, he died. And then I'll be like, that's not my fault, you need a better doctor. So yes, laughter can help heal. It's obviously, not going to heal you when you're in a dire, it's not going to get rid of your cold. But sure, it's good to laugh. I enjoy laughing. I enjoy people laughing when I'm on stage. And there's been nights, it's a mental thing, right? There's been evenings where I'm at home and I have to do a set up at the Comedy Store or the Laugh Factory, and I'm thinking, oh God, it's been a long day, I'm tired, I just want to put my feet up and watch my TV shows and relax and drink a glass of wine. But I'm on the calendar, I gotta go, and I'll get in my car and I'll drive over. And by the time I'm on stage and I'm talking to the audience and doing jokes, it helps me. I go, oh my God, I'm so happy I left the house. So it's sometimes just opening it up and observing it or being around it. I love when I run into people in my day-to-day life that aren't supposed to be funny, like a pharmacist or the person at the coffee shop or whatever. And if they've got that, they're alive, they want to laugh, they want you to laugh. It's surprising sometimes. You go, oh, hey, what a good guy, or what a good girl, or whatever it is. So I think it's important to us, and I think a lot of us get caught up so much in this narrow vision, tunnel vision of just getting through the day, that we forget how much laughter and levity can help others. Again, I've been in situations where maybe it's at the airport, or we've all had that moment on the airplane where the flight attendant decides to be funny and says a couple of things and everyone starts laughing and you're going, this is pretty cool, you know? So I thank the pharmacist for being a comedian as well.
That's great. No, in my own personal experience, especially with your comic relief, it has helped me and my family. And I don't call it laughter as medicine. I call it laughter as a healing power. Because it really makes you, the wonderful endorphins come about when, you know, before chemo, you listen to Maz Jobrani's Qatar TED talk and you start laughing so hard that you forget that you're going to have chemo in the next hour or so. So it truly is a healing power. Again, going back to your career, because when I talk to my students, especially the ones that are in their early 20s, they worry about, you know, what's next, you know, what major they have to, you know, take on in, as an undergraduate. You were a political science major. You finished your bachelor's at Cal Berkeley. With the political science. At the start of your career doing comedy, did you realize that you will be able to use what you did, you know, as an undergraduate and bring it into your art, let's say?
No, not really. No, I started doing plays at the age of 12 and I loved being on stage. I loved Eddie Murphy. I wanted to be like Eddie Murphy. And my parents, being immigrant parents, wanted me to be a lawyer or a doctor or an engineer. So there was a lot of back and forth with them. And I think a lot of young people have that probably. Most young people, some young people have parents who say, do whatever you want, I'll support you. But a lot of young people, I think, feel the pressure of their parents, of society, of finding what it is to do and being on that path. And at some point, there may be a voice deep down inside that says, this is not the thing that you want to do. And they go, well, yeah, but I'm already in my third year of medical school. I'm just going to see it through, even though I'm miserable. And then they go on and become a doctor. And then they go, oh, God, do you really love this? No, I wish I were a park ranger. Well, it takes some maturity to, at any given point, say, I'm throwing it all away. I'm going to go be a park ranger. And so for me, it took a while for me to get to that level of maturity because I kept saying actor, comedian. My parents kept saying lawyer, doctor, engineer. So I kept compromising. So going into college, I said, okay, I'll study political science, which then will lead me to go to graduate school and become, you know, go to law school and become a lawyer. And then maybe then I can like find time to do plays or comedy on the weekends or something like that. Like that was in the back of my mind that I will do it as a hobby because how do you make a living as a comedian? I have no idea. I didn't know. And so back and forth, junior year, I go to Italy. I study abroad in Italy, which is, I always tell college kids, if you can go study abroad anywhere, do it. It's one of the best years of your life. It opened my eyes up to this professor and what that professor was doing. And I thought, well, maybe I'll be a professor. So then I come home and I tell my mom, I'm not going to be a lawyer. I'm going to be a professor. She starts freaking out. What do you mean? Professors don't make any money. You should be a lawyer. And I'm going, this is what I want to do. So then I got into a PhD program at UCLA. And the very first year I realized to be a professor, you got to publish or perish. It's not about just the teaching in front of a class, which I thought would be fun, but publishing or perishing. Meanwhile, I was doing a play at the theater department at UCLA, and every time I was on stage, I felt alive. And the next day when I go to poli-sci classes, I just felt overwhelmed with publish or perish. So I just dropped out that first year from my PhD program. So again, it was this back and forth. And it wasn't until my mid-20s when I really had that light bulb moment that you live once, you got to live for yourself. You got to do what you love to do. And there was a gentleman, his name was Joe, And he was at the ad, I was, I had a day job in an advertising agency. I was just like an assistant. And Joe saw me do a play. Again, I was doing plays as a hobby. Saw me do the play and he goes, "Hey, you're funny. Have you ever thought about going after acting and comedy?" And I said, "You know, I've always thought about it and I'm 26 now and I'm waiting till I'm 30. I'm going to raise some money so that I can take some time off and pursue acting." And he says, "Listen, Maz, I'm in my 60s. This is Joe. And he goes, "There was a lot of stuff I wanted to do in my 20s and I just never did it. So he goes, "If you really want to do it now." And it was a light bulb moment. And so Joe Ryan inspired me, and I went to my boss. I said, "Listen, I'm going to really go hardcore with this comedy stuff." I enrolled in improv classes, ended up in stand-up comedy classes, and I just went. And I think what happens in your, and that was 23 years ago, and what happens in your late teens, early 20s, the pressures that are coming at you to do the, you know, SAT, GRE, LSATs, bar exam, you know, get married, get a life, get a mortgage, all that stuff is coming at you. You're like, oh, and you're looking around and some of your friends are going down that path and you're going, "Oh my God, I gotta just do this." Well, if you're honest with yourself, if you talk to yourself and really reflect and go, "What is it that I love? What is it that I was doing?" Whenever people are lost, I go, "What did you used to do as a kid that you loved?" You know, some kids love baseball. I go, "Okay, well, you're not going to be a professional baseball player, but maybe you can go coach a little league team. Maybe you can find a way into the professional baseball team that is in your town and go work in their offices. At least be surrounded by baseball. Go sell hot dogs at the baseball place, whatever it is. Just find that." And I think when you find that thing, then work is not work. Mm-hmm. It's fun. It's enjoyment, you know, because I, when I first started doing stand-up comedy, the number one thing we were taught was get on stage as much as you can, write as much as you can. So there was times where I was exhausted. I had a long day at the advertising agency working as an assistant. I'd come home and then I'd have to go to the comedy club and I might be at the club till 1 or 2 in the morning waiting to do 15 minutes because I was new. So I was at the end of the lineup and I still enjoyed every moment of it. I enjoyed watching these guys that I'd seen growing up that were performing in front of me who were celebrity comedians. I was like, "Oh my God, that's Paul Mooney. I can't believe I'm watching Paul Mooney," you know?
Yeah.
And so for me, it wasn't work. So really, if you can find that thing and go for it, then and not feel the pressures that you have to necessarily by the age of 23 know what you want to do. I changed a few times. I went from being, you know, originally I was going to go to college to study acting and I didn't do that. So then I was going to go be a lawyer. So I did poli sci. Mm-hmm. Then I was going to be a professor. Then I was going to go be in advertising. Then I realized my passion from before. So after I changed 4 or 5 times in the course of 4 or 5 years. So I never knew political science was going to be something that I would use in my comedy, but I've always been intrigued by politics and I've always been someone who tries to talk about hypocrisy when it happens. And so that became part of my stand-up.
The work you did on the Muslim ban was astounding. I thought that was, you know, the advocacy work you did around the Muslim ban a few years ago was amazing. We are coming to end of our, I don't want to take more of your time. You answered my follow-up questions in your answer in, you know, what you have to say to our youth, but we have a couple of comments I want to share. One is, thank you, Mr. Jobrani. I am pleased listening to you. Actually, you're a powerful public health educator. Keep doing the part-time public health work that you do for us. This is from Dr. Sheikh Hussein. And then one of our team members, Shams, says, "Mr. Jobrani, you mentioned that when you entered the comedy space, you were the only Iranian American in the game, and we can perhaps say that Omid Jalili was the main comedian in the UK. Given the relative boom of diversity over the last 20 years in comedy and entertainment world, how do you continue to reinvent yourself, both personally and creatively, to keep your comedy entertainment fresh, unique, and something you enjoy day after day?" Again, khalaqiyat. Let's say coming back.
Yes. Well, yeah, Omid was in England. Omid is one of my best friends and one of the funniest people I know. If you guys don't know Omid Jalili, you can find him on his Instagram page. And Jalili is with a D. So O-M-I-D and then Jalili, D-J-A-L-I-L-I. But you can find him on Instagram. One of the funniest, most talented people I know. And it's been nice because I was the first Iranian-American that was really doing it. I'm sure there's people before me, like Jamie Masada, who owns the Laugh Factory, who's Iranian-American as well. He's also Iranian, Israeli. He's got different backgrounds. So he had started doing stand-up comedy in the 70s, but then he became a club owner and went that way. So 98, I started. Shortly after me, Max Amini was in the game. There's Amir Kay. There's Tehran now, Omid Singh. There's a lot of great, funny comedians. And we all love each other. Just last night at the Laugh Factory, I did a fundraiser with an organization called the Children's Music Fund, where they provide music for children who are in hospitals. And we also raised some money for my sister. We lost my sister to breast cancer in 2017. So I have set up a scholarship in Maryam Jobrani's name at UC Berkeley, where the money goes to female students who want to study abroad. And so last night we raised money for Children's Music Fund and Maryam Jobrani Scholarship. And the lineup was me and Tehran and Max Amini. We were all in the lineup. Two other comedians, Kira Sultanovich and a guy named Ahmed Weinberg, who's very funny as well. His father was Jewish and converted to Islam, with this whole story. And Kira is Russian Jewish. Anyway, it was a great night. But my point is, there's only love between all of us. And what we try to do, what differentiates us, you know, you have a lineup with me, Tehran, and Max, and we all have Iranian backgrounds, but we have our own stories. Yes, sometimes a joke, if we, you know, we're talking about our Iranian mom or something, or Iranian dad, some of the jokes might sound similar. But for the most part, we have a lot of different experiences. I'm married with two children. I'm going to be talking about that. I just got a dog. I'm going to be talking about that. Max is traveling the world and dating. You know, I think he's dating. I don't know his status, but you know what I'm saying. He's talking about that. Tehran is half black, half Persian. He's going to talk about that. So, you know, we all, I think, have our own lanes. And ultimately, if you come from your stories and your truth, there will be times when I might say, like, oh, my dad wanted me to be a lawyer or a doctor or an engineer. And then Tehran might say the same thing because that's something we had in common. But once we tell the rest of our story, you see the differentiate, you know, how it's different. And so to be creative, you just got to keep talking from your own point of view and you keep writing. So like my last comedy special was called Pandemic Warrior. It's on Peacock TV. And before that, I had one on Netflix. The jokes from Netflix, I filmed that in 2017 at the Kennedy Center when Trump had just become president. A lot of political stuff in there, a lot of parenting stuff in there. The jokes on Pandemic Warrior, I filmed that in 2019 in Dubai. So it was what had happened between 2017 to 2019. So I'm talking about the next 2 years of my life. And I put some clips of doing comedy under the pandemic from the closet into the show as well. So it covers some of the pandemic. So as long as you keep talking about how you're evolving and your life is changing, your material will always be new. Some of the themes might be the same because those are the themes that interest me. But the materials, I know that you and your son were at the show in Boston recently. Those jokes are different than any jokes I'd done before because I'm telling the story of getting my dog. I'm telling the story of, you know, life under the pandemic. I'm telling the story of mask protests. So that's all newer stuff. So really, I think it's about, and I personally would get bored if I wasn't talking about my, if I were still telling jokes about my kids being babies, when in reality they're now 13 and 10. So now I have a whole other world to deal with. So that's where we create more and more, is just being in touch with what's going on in our lives and bringing that to stage. And that differentiates all of us.
And also enjoying yourself. I mean, if you enjoy yourself while you're doing it, you relate that to your audience. And that's, you know, in the times that I've come to see you, I, you know, even if I heard the joke before, I love it again because your presentation becomes different. And we use that for our work, you know, when we are relaying science. Unfortunately, we are running out of time. There are more questions from our audience members. My apologies to you guys that we can't have time to, you know, have all the questions answered. I'm gonna wrap this up. Thank you, Maz, in the spirit of mentorship and leadership. For our young people and our next generation, I'd like to frame our conversation around hope. We keep our focus. When we keep our focus and mission, we need to continue to challenge ourselves. And it seems like you do that every day when you get on stage and reimagine our methodology to be successful. We have a tradition at Teatime, and I usually finish the Teatimes with a quotation. Today's quotation is from Muhammad Ali. The man who has no imagination has no wings. And you, Maz, have been flying high with so many wonderful adventures in your life, both personally and professionally. And thank you for relaying that to us. I'm grateful for your time and your insight. Everyone, he was on October 1st, he was in a majestic Wilbur Theater. Please check out his Instagram page and his tour to see. I think in the next couple of months, you're going to be in California. I'd like to thank Miss Sabrina Liali. I hope I'm pronouncing the last name right. And Ray Mohit for facilitating my conversation with Maz and answering all of our questions patiently. And also Miss Sammy O'Reilly and Shams Mohajirani on my team for really working hard to bring this to you. Thank you, everybody. Stay curious, stay interested, stay tuned, and check our website for our next Teatime, which will be on World AIDS Day on December 1st and my guest will be President Obama's United Nations appointee, Ambassador Eric Goosby. Thank you, everybody. And thank you, Maz. This was amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate you guys. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.